In this screencast, we're going to talk about similitude, or the idea of using a model to generate data and predict behaviors on an actual prototype. So sometimes it's not feasible to run experiments with an intended prototype, either because of time, cost, resources, availability, to name a few reasons. So instead, we build models and we run experiments on the models to predict how the prototype, the actual object, will behave under similar conditions. So the idea of generating similar conditions is called similitude. Now, in this screencast, we'll work through an example of this type of modeling in similitude to predict the actual behavior. Let's imagine we come across a glacier. We build a model of this glacier in lab. And so the model is out of ice with a specific gravity of 0.92. Now, through experimentation, we find that it takes 5.5 hours for an object to move from one point in the model to another point. Data collected from the actual glacier indicates the density of the glacier is similar to that of glycerin, so specific gravity of 1.26, but is 1,000,000 times more viscous than the fluid we use in our model. We want to know how long would it actually take in the actual glacier to move from a scaled length, point A to point B. First thing is we have to get some idea of how one variable is affected by others. So here, we're going to look at the velocity of the glacier, and we're going to know that the velocity is going to be a function of the length that the glacier has to travel, its viscosity, its density, as well as the acceleration due to gravity. So we want the time in our prototype. We're trying to determine how long it would take for the glacier to move a certain distance. So here, we could calculate time by the length it travels. So really, this is the length of our prototype divided by the velocity of our prototype. Now, what we're hoping to do is if we could figure out what the length over the velocity of our model is, then maybe we could predict L over V of our prototype. So we know we have the velocity as a function of length, viscosity, density, and gravity. So to create similitude between the prototype and the model, we don't match all the variables to be the same because they aren't, as we mentioned. We match certain sets of variables, specifically dimensionless ones. So this way, regardless of our system of units, we can make comparisons if we know the results from a certain set of conditions. Now, there are other screencasts you could view to refer to, what's known as the Buckingham Pi theorem, that explains this process. So I'm going to use this method to create our dimensionless terms. So first, we need to determine how many dimensionless terms we will have. So we do this by subtracting the number of dimensions from the number of variables. So the number of variables are 5, again. So our dimensions to characterize these 5 variables are mass, length, and time. So we have 3. So our dimensionless pi terms is just 5 minus 3, so we'll have 2 different terms. So the second part is we need to label our dimensionless pi terms. One will be the dependent variable. So we know we have the first pi term, which is going to be a function of our dependent variable, velocity. The second part is we have to choose another parameter to represent our second pi term. So we don't want to choose a variable that has, say, all 3 dimensions if the other variables we use to try to make it dimensionless won't allow us to cancel it out. So viscosity is fairly safe. Viscosity has mass, length, and time, and the other variables that we haven't named so far that have density, gravity, and length will allow us to cancel that out, and you'll see. So this means that our pi term that has velocity in it is going to contain velocity, density, gravity, and length, possibly. These are our 3 repeating variables that we're going to use. And then in our second case, we'll have those same repeating variables, although they may or may not be used to make it dimensionless. So what we should do at this point is write the dimensions down for each of these variables. So velocity is a length per time. Density is a mass per length cubed. Viscosity is a mass per length per time. Acceleration due to gravity is a length per time squared. And then lastly, length is just length. So now we have our dimensions for each of our variables. Now we need to combine these groups to create a dimensionless parameter. So the way we do that is in looking at the first pi group, we know that we're going to take the velocity and multiply it by some combination of the other repeating variables. So I write rho to the A, G to the B, L to the C. And what happens is our final dimensions, M, L, and T, all must have a zero power. So now we can set this up, and we write LT minus 1 times the dimensions of density to the A power, the dimensions of gravity to the B power, and the dimensions of length to the C power. So right away we have one mass term, and that's it. So we know that A must be equal to zero. So now we can approach either length or time. I'm going to do length, and we'll see that with length, we get 1 minus 3A plus B plus C has to be equal to zero. Well, we know A is zero, so that tells us that B plus C is equal to negative 1. So now let's look at the time dimension. Here we show minus 1 minus 2b is equal to 0. So now we know b is equal to negative 1 half, which means c is equal to negative 1 half. So now to create our pi group, we have velocity times density to the 0 power times gravity to the negative 1 half times length to the negative 1 half. So that's our first dimensionless parameter. Now we repeat this process for the second pi group, and I'll show you the work here. So this is the work you should get when you repeat this for the viscosity term, which means that our second pi group will be viscosity over density times length times the square root of g over l. We have two dimensionless groups. What do we do now? So similitude means that if we have our second pi group of our model equal to the second pi group of our prototype, then that means our first pi group of our model must also be equal to our first pi group of our prototype. So if we could set one dimensionless parameter, like the second pi group, to be equal in both cases, the model and the prototype, then we could predict what our prototype pi 1 term should be because we can measure the pi 1 term in our model. So if you look at these two pi groups, we could get an idea of what the length of our model must be compared to our prototype if we use the second pi groups because we have relationships for the viscosity and the density between the model and the prototype. So what I mean by this is that all of the variables for our model put into this form must be the same as those for our prototype. So we can start plugging in values, or at least rewriting this to get relationships that we know. For instance, gravity is not changing in either the model or our prototype, so that drops out of this relationship right away. We could rewrite these ratios so that we have the ratio of the viscosity of the model over that of the prototype times the ratio of the density of the prototype over that of the model. And this must be equal to the ratio of the length of the model over the length of the prototype to the 3/2 power. So in the problem statement, the viscosity of our model was a million times less than that of the actual glacier. And the density of the prototype, the glacier, was 1.26 over the specific gravity of our model, 0.92. So now if we take this to the 2/3, we'll get the relationship between our model length and our prototype length. If I do this calculation, I get 1.23 times 10 to the minus 4. So now we have an idea of our length scales. Now we could go back to our first pi term and determine the difference in our velocities. So again, when we set these equal, we could drop the gravity term and we could rearrange this so that the velocity of our prototype, which we're looking for, is the velocity of our model times the ratio of LP over LM to the 1/2. So we're not given velocities. We have to rewrite this as the length of our prototype over the time, length of our model over the time of our model, times this ratio. Now we're solving for the time in our prototype. So the time of our prototype is equal to the time of our model times LP over LM times LM over LP to the 1/2. So now, using this ratio we scaled before, we could plug that in here as well as here, and we're given a time. So this looks like the following. So I get a time of our glacier of 495 hours, which is approximately 21 days. So I hope this screencast gives you an idea on how to use similitude and create dimensionless pie groups to scale between a model and an actual prototype.